disease that predominantly involve the right ventricle and is characterized pathologically by fibrofatty replacement of the right ventricular myocardium and clinically by ventricular arrhythmias, potentially leading to sudden death, mostly in young people and athletes. In the last two decades, advances in molecular genetics have provided important, significant insights in our understanding of the pathogenesis of this condition by showing that this disease is a desmosomal cardiomyopathy characterized by defective cell adhesion protein such as placoglobin, desmoglein, desmocholine, placophyllin, and desmoplakin proteins. The incorporation in the desmosome of defective proteins predispose desmosomes to be vulnerable to disruption, especially during condition of stress, and subsequently can account for myocyte degeneration and death with fibrofatty replacement. The diagnosis of this condition is based on task force criteria for diagnosis that are based on the typical electrocardiographic and arrhythmic features such as repolarization abnormalities in right precordial leads, left bundle branch block morphology, ventricular arrhythmias, and morphofunctional right ventricular abnormalities that can be evidenced by echocardiography, angiography, and more recently by contrast enhanced MRI, and by typical histopathologic features of fibrofatty replacement of the myocardium and of typical familial and genetic factors. Recently, the traditional task force criteria for diagnosis of ICD have been modified. We propose the modification of the classical criteria mostly in order to increase the daily diagnostic sensitivity for detection of first relatives with earlier minor form of familial ARVCD and to provide quantitative criteria for right ventricular dilatation dysfunction by different imaging techniques. Furthermore, an aim of this revision of the diagnostic criteria was to add molecular genetic criteria for diagnosis. So in terms of natural history, this condition is mostly characterized by ventricular electrical instability that can lead to sudden arrhythmic death anytime during the disease course. Secondarily, this disease is characterized by a progressive loss of right ventricular myocardium and left ventricular involvement leading to heart failure, usually late during life. So the incidence of sudden death is the most important evolution of the natural history of this condition is probably lower in adults with a diagnosis treated ARVC compared with adolescents and young adults that usually die earlier and probably with a higher incidence. Most important is the circumstances of death. This condition is a leading cause of sudden death in athletes and account for arrhythmic cardiac arrest during athletic competition. A study that we carried out during a very long period in Italy aimed to demonstrate the trends of sudden cardiovascular death in young competitive athletes after implementation of a nationwide pre-participation screening program showed that as compared with the era, pre-screening era, after the implementation of an obligatory screening for all individuals embarking in sport activity was characterized by a sharp decline of sudden cardiovascular death over the time. You can see that the incidence death declined for 4 per 100,000 person per year to 0.4 after 24 years of obligatory screening. That accounts for a 90% reduction of mortality. Compelled in no change with regard to the incidence, the trend of incidence of sudden cardiovascular death among non-screened, non-athletes from the same region. And the most important Most of reduced mortality was due to reduction mortality due to cardiomyopathies, mostly hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. A parallel study we conducted showed that the reduction in the number of atrial dying suddenly due to this cardiomyopathy was paralleled by an increasing number of young living athletes who were identified during the study period with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy and were protected from the risk of athletics, of sport activity. What about the other risk factors? Ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation are obvious risk factors for sudden death, but other primary risk factor for sudden death have been identified, including syncope, the young age, time of diagnosis, a malignant family history, left ventricular involvement, non-sustained VT, or inducibility on programmed ventricular stimulation. Management strategy of this condition include pharmacologic therapy, mostly based on beta blockers, and non-pharmacologic therapy, including catheter ablation and implantable cardioverter defibrillation. The efficacy of catheter ablation for prevention of sudden death remains to be established. Instead, implantable cardioverter defibrillator candidates the logical therapy for a condition whose the natural history is strongly related to the risk of arrhythmic cardiac arrest during the clinical course. And actually, ICD was consistently proven to reduce mortality in high-risk affected patients, and the mortality reduction was estimated to range from 20 to 30%. What is extremely important is that by using ICD for prevention of sudden death in different categories of patients with ICD, we had the possibility to identify clinical and electrophysiologic markers which can predict the occurrence of appropriate shock against life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias, in other terms, life-saving shocks. Either in patients who receive an ICD for secondary or primary prevention. I will focus your attention, on Darwin studies that are international multicenter study we coordinate in Padua, and were studies on the ICD in arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, either for primary or secondary prevention. The first study was the Darwin one, was published in 2003, and was a secondary prevention studies. You can appreciate that the majority of ARVCD patients were received an ICD due to cardiac arrest or ventricular tachycardia. And you can see here that over a mean follow-up period of 3.3 years, roughly half of this patient actually experienced an appropriate ICD intervention consisting of shocks, anti-tachycardia pacing, or both. What is interesting is that 25% of this patient actually experience an episode of ventricular fibrillation or ventricular flutter, as shown by analysis of the ECG stored by the device. And you can see here, this is an example of this arrhythmia ventricular fibrillation, and ventricular fibrillation or flutter show no tendency to be self-terminating, and usually result in sudden death unless correctly measured and ascertained promptly. So we use this arrhythmia, these patients with ventricular fibrillation, to construct, to project survival curves. You can see here, this is the actual survival curve, showing those patients who actually died during the follow-up. And the second curve instead indicates those patients who experience an episode of ventricular fibrillation or ventricular flutter that would have been fatal in the absence of the device. Incredible. So it's a theoretic curve of mortality. And you can see here that the divergence between the two lines, the two curves, reflect the estimated survival benefit of ICD therapy that after 3 years of follow-up was roughly 30%. So another important sub-analysis was that Kaplan-Meier analysis of ICD intervention against ventricular fibrillation flutter, in other words, on life-saving ICD intervention, showed that different subgroups stratified by the reason for ICD implantation had a different prognosis, particularly those presenting with ventricular tachycardia without hemodynamic compromise had a significantly lower incidence of ventricular fibrillation or flutter over the follow-up, indicating a better prognosis. So multivariable analysis showed that the age, left ventricular ejection fraction, cardiac arrest, and ventricular tachycardia with hemodynamic compromise were the most important predictors of ventricular fibrillation over the follow-up. And you can see another important finding was that inducibility at programmed ventricular stimulation didn't predict the occurrence of ventricular fibrillation flutter over the follow-up, regardless of the clinical presentation of these individuals. More recently, we published the Darwin II studies, that's a primary prevention studies. In other words, these ARVC patients received an ICD in the absence of a history of ventricular fibrillation or ventricular tachycardia. They were implanted because unexplained syncope, non-sustained VT, or just for a family history of sudden death. And you can see here that over a long-term follow-up, roughly one-fourth of these patients actually received an appropriate ICD intervention, and the comparison between the actual mortality, 100% of patients survived over this long-term follow-up, and the theoretical curves show that the mortality, the survival benefit of ICD could be estimated around 23%. And syncope was statistically significant, significantly associated with the occurrence of either any appropriate ICD intervention or ICD intervention against ventricular fibrillation or ventricular flutter. Instead, non-sustained VT was associated with just any appropriate ICD intervention. On multivariate analysis, only syncope remained an independent predictors of shocks of ventricular fibrillation or against any appropriate ICD intervention with a hard ratio of around 3. So this data allowed us to construct a pyramid of risk for patients with ARVCD. You can see that, of course, the patient with the highest risk of ventricular fibrillation leading to sudden cardiac death are those with we survived an aborted sudden cardiac death, those with the hemodynamically unstable sustained ventricular tachycardia, and importantly, those with unexplained syncope. For this patient that show an incidence of ventricular fibrillation over the follow-up ranging from 8 to 10% per year, the ICD implantation is mandatory. Instead, for the large group of patients that are probands or relatives fulfilling the task force diagnostic criteria, so they actually definitely had a diagnosis of the disease, regardless of a family history of sudden death or indisability of programmed ventricular stimulation. Programmed ventricular stimulation doesn't predict ventricular fibrillation over the follow-up, the risk is lower, is less than 1% per year, and probably systematic ICD implantation is unjustified. Patients with instead hemodynamically well-tolerated VT or non-sustained VT have an intermediate risk of 1-2% per year, and the indication for ICD implantation should be individualized. Thank you for your attention.
Excellent. It's open for discussion, please.
So I have a.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
So I have a question. It's a beautiful presentation, and it's magnificent to see that this is life-saving. You know, this is not theoretical, but it really is primary and secondary prevention at its best. Now, the question is: since these patients tend to develop hemodynamic abnormalities later, are you postponing? Are you seeing patients in who have had multiple shocks, whose lives you've saved, then go on to heart failure?
Yeah.
Or hemodynamic compromise, who didn't have it before?
Yeah. Maybe that over the time, of course, the situation of these patients changes. In other words, the hemodynamic part and changes over the time.
Yeah.
So at the time of the implantation, the ICD is life-saving at the first.
Yes, yeah, but do you see them developing hemodynamic compromise?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because you have some patients there that in the primary prevention who I saw went for six years.
During the follow-up, you can observe, the occurrence of heart failure in this ARVCD patient that may be a right heart failure or biventricular heart failure, and because of progression of the disease.
Yes.
So in this patient, probably there is indication for ICD implantation where there is a decrease of the left ventricle, right ventricle ejection fraction below the.
So these patients may then need mechanical support or transplantation.
Of course, as a last option, therapeutic option.
Please.
Can I just ask one question, please? Regarding the difference between echocardiographic findings between the AVRC and the non-compaction of the RV, is there a way to differentiate in echoes? Because you've kindly listed the modalities of diagnosis, but I'm just asking if we talk. Is it difficult to differentiate between the non-compaction and AVRC of the involving the RV?
Yeah, of course.
In echoes, is it easy?
We are dealing with the right ventricular disease, so you know the right ventricle is by definition non-compact. So the problem is that with the left ventricular involvement in the right ventricular cardiomyopathy, because usually there is a left ventricular non-compact.
So
ventricle.
We don't get RV non-compaction for genetic counseling.
No problems. I mean, with the differentiation.
So if only it involves the LV, and what is the MRI role in the diagnosis of AVRC?
Yeah, of course, my MRI is very important for differential diagnosis, and because for the left ventricular involvement, because in the non-compactation you can find the typical features of the non-compact left ventricle. Instead, in arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, you observe also the sign of scar, especially in the late enhancement test with the gadolinium. So it's very important, the MRI, for differential diagnosis.
Thank you. I have a question related to Dr. Brownell's question. Have you been monitoring left and or right ventricular function sequentially in the patients who have or have not had appropriate shocks?
No, there is not a relationship between shocks and the kind of evolution of the progression of the disease in terms of right or left ventricular involvement.
You've looked at that?
Yeah, we looked. And we of course, for reason of time, I didn't report any type of correlation. We also considered the left ventricular function, right ventricular function at the time of implantation over the time. And we didn't find any relationship.
Domenico, I have another question. Yes. Fine. Please.
What do you do for the first degree relative if he's getting some frequent PVCs or non-sustained VTEC?
According to our results, isolated premature ventricular beats, or coupled ventricular beats in itself are not associated with increased risk. So we usually treat these arrhythmias that are not life-threatening in itself by beta blockers. For those with non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, is different. We found a kind of association between non-sustained ventricular tachycardia and appropriate intervention of the ICD against monomorphic VT, not against ventricular fibrillation. In other words, non-sustained VT, according to our result, is not a predictor of ventricular fibrillation and sudden cardiac death in this patient. But I think that a particular subgroup are those with non-sustained ventricular tachycardia during effort or effort-induced. So in this subgroup of patients, probably an ICD is justified because, these are more at risk to degenerate into VF.
Just I have a final question. You are an expert on sport cardiology and demonstrate that the decline of sudden death in athletes was mostly due to early detection of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. Should you comment on the specificity and the sensitivity of the electrocardiogram in making early diagnosis in asymptomatic patients?
Yeah, this is a very important point because in the Italian program, the Italian screening protocol is essentially based on electrocardiogram. We don't perform echo to everybody. In other words, the first line examination is a family history, personal history, a physical examination, and 12 ECG. Only those with positive findings, the first line examination, undergo further examinations such as echo, exercise testing, and so on. So the, according to our data, ECG is very sensitive for condition at high risk of sudden death, like hypertrophic, such as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. We know that more than 90% of patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy shows T-wave subversion, pathologic T-waves, and so on. And more than 90% of those with ARVCD, with arrhythmogenic ventricular cardiomyopathy, that also show inverted T-waves, lengthening of QRS in the precordial leads, and so on. So the ECG is very sensitive. And also, the specificity is good because if you consider that after the adolescence, the concept of the juvenile pattern of repolarization that is relatively non-specific is very low. We demonstrate it's less than 1.5%. When you find a T-wave subversion beyond V1 in the hypercordial leads, these individuals merit further examination because they can have an underlying right ventricular cardiomyopathy.
Just V1, not V2.
Beyond V1, V1, beyond V1, because in V1 is normal.
V1 is wrong. Just fine now, just one, but very, very quick, and very quick answer.
Having an RF ablation for them. Thank you very much.
Of course, if the shock are triggered by monomorphic VT, if the shock are triggered by monomorphic VT, of course VT is an exceptional, very, very good option. Otherwise, you have to consider other possibilities such as heart transplantation.